granddaughter, Richard and Frances Jones from Hungary, Peter Roberts in Jamaica, Florence Hay in Jamaica, Aileen Brooks from Australia, and for everyone else that's online today, a very warm welcome and thank you so much for joining with us. I first want to invite the Reverend Jason Heron to come and open our time together in prayer.
Don't think I needed that to celebrate Ted's life. As Pentecostals, we should pray without notes, but I wanted to actually write down a prayer, so wouldn't take all day either. So can we pray, please? Heavenly Father, we are truly thankful for the hope we have in Jesus and for the promise of eternal life. As we gather today to give thanks and celebrate Ted's life, we are grateful for Ted's faithfulness and commitment to you throughout many decades. Also for his example and encouragement to so many of our lives. So as we pray and continue today, I ask you that you would strengthen the family and especially Nancy, who can't be with us. And we just invite the Holy Spirit that you would give us your peace and joy as we celebrate this special day. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Jason. I'm going to invite you to stand if you are able to, so that we can sing our first hymn together, which I know was a favourite of Ted's. I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene. And I just want to let you know that the worship is being led by all members of Ted's family, which is really beautiful.
Yep, this one was Ted's favourite, my dad's favourite. I stand amazed in the presence. It talks about the chorus, how marvellous, how wonderful. Dad believed these words intrinsically, he really did.
Again.
please take your seats. As we were singing that, I just have memories of Ted going, marvellous. He'd always put his hands up saying, marvellous. I'd like to invite Reverend Adam Eakins to bring our first Bible reading. Okay.
The reading is 1 Thessalonians 4, verses 13 to 18. Brothers and sisters, we do not want you to be uninformed about those who sleep in death, so that you do not grieve like the rest of mankind, who have no hope. For we believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. According to the Lord's word, we tell you that we who are still alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command and with the voice of archangels and with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words.
Thank you, Adam. I'm going to invite us again to stand for our second hymn together, How Great is Our God.
How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will sing, how great is our God. How great is our God. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. All will say, how great is our God. The splendor of the King, wealth and majesty, let my heart rejoice, and all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in
Seats. I'm now going to invite Stuart, Richard and Rob to bring their tributes of their dad. And just while they're getting ready, I want to take this opportunity to let you know that after the service, the family invite you to stay with them to have refreshments. And there will be a time, if you want to bring your a short tribute of Ted, your any special memories, there'll be opportunity in that section then. So just invite you to come.
Thank you. I just want to sing a tribute to my dad. I'm not going to say too much. I just want this song to say everything that I feel, everything that dad meant to me. I love my dad, still love my dad. He wasn't just my dad, he was my best friend. He was a guy that you could talk to. He was inspirational, he was steadfast, he was just dependable. And what made him dependable was his faith in God, faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And sometimes we go through difficulties in our lives, sometimes we go through difficult times, bereavement, sickness, financial difficulty, maybe relational problems, all sorts of things that we go through in our lives. But at the heart of it all, my dad knew who his God was. And he knew the Lord Jesus Christ is his own and personal Savior in a real and personal way. And so I want to sing this song, You're Still God.
When all foundations have been shaken, when I'm left standing in the dark, still reign and you're still God. And when I feel all hope has faded, the heavy questions hit so hard, and though my soul may feel forsaken, you still reign and you're still God. Whisper that you're not, you'll never leave me nor forsake me, 'cause you still reign and you're still God. Though I can't see what's before me, I know that I can trust your this one truth will be my story. Your truth still reigns and you're still God. Though I can't see what's before me, I know that I can trust your heart. And this one truth will be my story. You still reign and you're still God. When my enemies surround me, I'll trust the victory of your cross and fix my eyes upon you, Jesus. For you are God and I am not. You are good and you are faithful, as you have been from the start. You're working all things for your glory, 'cause you still reign and you're still God. I know that I can trust your heart, and this one truth will be my story, that you still reign and you're still God. Yes, this one truth will be my story, you still reign and you're still God.
That's my dad's testimony and mine.
Good. I'll write it down so I wouldn't forget it. It's an honor for me to speak about my father, my dad. And of course I miss him, but I have such a wonderful memories of him and over many years. And having spent more time with my father than most people do with theirs, I have also done the family tree, and over the last 12 years I've found out a lot about his life that I didn't know before. I genuinely don't have any regrets. Incredible to me. I have no regrets. I said everything to my dad. He said everything to me, and we were fine. No regrets. And I'm so thankful for that, because we shared our lives together. He didn't try and interfere in my life. He would give it his opinion, but he was always there, but he let me make my own mind up. Of course, he was always there if I needed him, and he would encourage me if I got things wrong. But he would never hold my mistakes against me, and I didn't argue with him. Some of you nodding now and saying, well, he wasted time anyway. But we would always listen. He would always listen to me, and if I got things wrong, he sometimes needed to be put right. He would accept the apology, and we both got on with it. No bad feelings, no recriminations. He kept no records of wrongs and always showed forgiveness. He did not see the problems. He only saw solutions. And how many of us live with problems at the forefront of our life? But there was always a solution to my dad. He was so positive, and I'm certain that this helped him into long life. My dad always told me that I should be confident about myself and not to compare myself to others. He said, I was as good as anyone else, but of course I had to learn some of these things for myself. But I've always remembered those words. It had such an effect upon my life. Of course, I remember the holidays in Two Wells and Norfolk. Mum and Dad lived there between 1944 and 1946, and we would visit some friends they had made during that time in Wells. Then there were holidays to Clacton and Mumbles on the Gawa, a coast in South Wales, all good memories. He played football for the school team, but they couldn't win a game, but 2 years after leaving school at 14, the team joined the local league, and they were third the first year, and it was quite an achievement after losing their streak at school and then the title winners in 1936. Wonderful, yeah. Yeah. Dad was a cricketer. He played for the Royal District Council, I think, and we would go and watch him play in and around Northampton. He played hockey in Egypt, And he was, when he was in the RAF, and now you know why we're both a bit football mad in our family. He wasn't perfect, and he could be sharp on certain occasions, and you definitely knew when he wasn't happy. I remember a story he told me when he was working on a building site which concerned a cheeky young plumber. This young man was given my dad a tough time with so much chatter. So when the plumber had to go under the timber floor joist to complete some pipe work, my dad and his mate nailed the floorboards down. So he couldn't get out. To teach him a lesson, of course. His scar for life. There was a TV program, I don't know if you remember it, some of you older people might remember this, a number of years ago now called This Is Your Life. And it featured some famous sports person, film star, you know, someone in the public eye. They would do an overview of their lives and bringing guests to speak about how they were connected to that person by filming them prior to the broadcast. Or they would be a guest, actually, on the show. And he would say, Eamon Andrews would say, well, he is here tonight, and the guest would then make this surprise appearance. Well, you could also utter these same words this afternoon. I could say, Alwyn Ingram, the cheeky young plumber, nailed under the floorboards, is here this afternoon to tell his story. But I won't do that. But he is here today. After all those years, to be remembered by his friend and colleagues. After all those years, it was amazing when suddenly the doorbell went at my dad's house, and who should be standing there but was Al, not a plumber anymore, but selling fruit and vegetables and eggs, etc. And suddenly their eyes met. And the friendship has continued after all these years, you know, which is, it's fantastic. My dad skipped school on a couple of occasions. Firstly, in 1928, Sir Alum Cobham Flying Circus display team were doing a display down at the River Nen below Weston Favell, where airplanes were doing stunts and then taking passengers up for flights for 2 and 6 pence. That's for 12.5p, everybody else, youngsters. Secondly, in 1929 and 1930, he followed the air balloon, the R100, or it might have been the R101, with some friends whilst going, which was going through trials from Cardington, Bedfordshire, down through the River Nen Valley. Definitely a clip round the ear for both of those occasions, I think. And so the clip at the ears that he had, he used to give us. It was never a real clabber of a smack round the ear, but it just really got you one on there. And we were all, recipients of that. He married the love of his life, who we met in 1936, and married Nancy Evans in December 1944, achieving over 77 years of marriage. I suppose the best way to describe my relationship with my dad would be to say that he was my mate. Dad was a carpenter, and when I finished my time as an apprentice joiner, I went to work with him on the building sites, and I learnt quickly how important your mate is in that environment. You watch out for each other. You anticipate what the next move is as you work, and you become an extension of each other. I like working with my dad. We laughed together, spoke about important issues, ate baked beans from a thermos flask, sitting next to a tilly lamp to keep warm while we had a break at work. He taught me the tricks of the trade, and he paid me at the end of the week, which was okay. So here I am today, unscathed, and I give my thanks to my mate, to my friend, to my mentor, my dad. Thank you, Dad, for the example you set us, your family, a man who loved God, his family, and all those who he came into contact with. Thank you, Dad.
Now you've got the baby of the family. My dad, what a man. He's been an amazing influence on my life. And I didn't always appreciate it though, particularly when I was younger. When I was in my early teens, I strongly resented it. I thought he was out of touch, didn't know very much, and was too tough on me in many ways.
By the time I got to 20 years of age, I was amazed at how much he'd developed, how much he'd learned, and how much wiser he was. Guess which one of us had grew up? Dad put boundaries in my life, and I'm so glad he did, because I needed those to not overstep those boundaries. And he taught me that there were consequences when you overstepped those boundaries. I understood discipline better, and it was essential for me. He didn't just talk the talk, he walked the walk. He was a shining example of standing for something or else you'll fall for anything. Stand for something or else you'll fall for anything. Our country today could do with a few more Ted Kinnings. 18 years ago, in September 2004, something dramatic happened to Dad, which had a profound effect upon my life. Dad was 84 years of age, and I'd just turned 50. I had a call from my sister-in-law, Diane, who phoned me at work to say, Dad's been beaten up, and he's lying in hospital at the moment. I just couldn't get my head around it. He'd been hit with a 3-foot block of wood, and he ended up with broken cheek, broken eye socket. The story was featured in the Chronicle and Echo at the time, and I don't have time to go into the details of that today. But I don't know how Dad managed to survive that brutal beating. But what I really want to tell you about is Dad's even more amazing response to what happened. The awful incident messed my life up quite badly, and I didn't handle things at all well. When I was driving back from work in Daventry on my way back to the hospital, all sorts of things were going through my mind. Raging fear, anger, hatred, deepest, darkest emotions I didn't think it possible for a Christian to have. I was angry. I was mad. And I went through some dark times during those first few weeks after this beating, both mentally and emotionally. It was not helped by the fact that Dad wouldn't get angry about it. Oh yes, he wanted to see justice. He wanted this person caught. But he wouldn't get angry. Dad had moved on. I said to him, Dad, get angry! I got some details about victim compensation for him. And he screwed it up and threw it in the bin. That made me even more angry. Oh, Dad, I learned so much about my dad through this experience. What a great man he was, of courage, of strength, of mind and body, and character too. You see, Dad had experienced what it was to receive forgiveness in his own life and how liberating that had been for him. And he also knew that having received forgiveness, he needed to give forgiveness, even to those who don't deserve it. But I couldn't accept this at the time. By his example, though, I was brought to my senses, and I'm pleased to say that I found forgiveness, and it enabled me to move on. I had to choose the path that I didn't want to choose. You know, it's not weakness to forgive. It's actually a strength to forgive. Thank you, Dad, for teaching me. I need to continually learn to forgive and also be forgiven. One of the things that really stands about my dad to me is his consistency. He was not a moody man. He was always the same. You knew what you were going to get when you met up with him. He was always so positive. You would find it hard to find a more positive person than my dad. One of his favorite phrases was, and he was the king of the one-liners, was, "Today's today, live it. Today's today, live it." In the last few years, Dad had been in Northampton General Hospital quite a few times for head lesions. He had cancer, skin cancer on his head, and he broke a few bones at different times. His left femur, his right femur. Before he died, he broke his arm and his shoulder. He went into hospital a number of times, and the thing that always happened when he went into hospital was that the nurses, consultants, and doctors always said, "Your dad is so inspirational. He brings such a lightness to the ward when he comes upon it." You know, he seemed to do that every time that he went into hospital. I think that's one of the things that God allowed him to do, to go there to cheer them all up. And NHS staff, some of them were going to try to be here today. I don't know if anybody's from NHS today were going to make it. No? But let's give them a round of applause, shall we? They do an incredible job, don't they? I thank God for the way he was looked after in hospital. He was looked after so well, and I thank God for them all. Another of Dad's one-liners towards the end of his life was this: I can till I can't. I can till, in other words, I can do everything. He wouldn't focus on what he couldn't do. He focused on what he could do. I can till I can't. Well, he did that with breath. He did it until he couldn't draw another breath. And he finally passed away. God called you home, Dad. You were promoted to glory. To see his Lord and Saviour. What rejoicing there was in heaven when Dad arrived. I get a bit emotional when I think of him. You know the words of an old song, and I'm going to finish with this. We'll meet again. I do know where, but I don't know when. But I know we'll meet again one sunny day. I know where he's gone, and I know I will see him someday. Dad has left us a family legacy which is priceless. No amount of money could purchase this legacy of love, consistency, and positivity. He was one of a kind. He was one of a kind. When I grow up, I want to be like you, Dad.
Weren't they amazing? Amazing. You know, I know we've just clapped Stuart, Richard, and Rob. I think let's just give God a clap for just who he is through Ted, who he's been through Ted. Oh, wonderful, wonderful. Right, I'm going to invite us to stand for... Sorry, I just need to get this in order. Okay, we've got other tributes. Sorry, we've got five other tributes from other members of Ted's family. Paul and Sarah are going to give a video tribute, and Liz and Mark and Joe. And just before we play Paul's video, in your order of service, I just want to mention that there's a little card. You've got a little postcard, and the family are inviting you to assist them in creating a keepsake book of memories. And if you have any special memories that you want to write down, put them down before you leave, if possible, and place them in there's a bucket as you walk out through the door, and maybe another one around. So they want to create a special booklet of memories and thoughts and best wishes. So if you're able to do that, that would be fabulous. We're now going to have a video from Paul. Oh, yes, you are going to sing for it. I knew there was something else on here, sorry. Apologies. Moment.
You can sit back and enjoy this one. You haven't got to stand. You can just sit there and drink it in. Just enjoy this song together. It's great for us today as family to play together. You know, we've never, ever played together as family. We've all been musically inclined over the years and so on, and some of us have worked together and done things, but we've never actually played together. So it's been a real joy today to come together and just to minister in song to you. We want to sing a song that says, I speak Jesus. Listen to the words of these songs. They are powerful words.
Thank you.
starts to grow. Declaring there's hope and there is freedom, I speak Jesus.
Going to have the other family tributes, so and the first one is going to be from Paul in Australia.
Hello, Kenny Clan, family and friends. Wish we could be with you guys at this celebration of Grandpa But unfortunately we can't. We are stuck here in Albury Botanical Gardens, and we thought we'd just say a few words about Grandpa. Maggie, what do you think of when you think of Grandpa King?
He's very old, 102, which is incredible. He makes us laugh a lot, and he's very courageous.
He was very courageous. He gave us so many lessons, didn't he?
Yes.
His legacy for us has been that love of family and of life, and also the strong faith that he had. The gardens here, we're in the Albury Botanical Gardens. It makes us think about his foundational skills, his pickles. We miss his pickles, don't we?
Yes.
But those lessons of being able to be grounded in where you are, what you're about, and take that with you. So all the best with the celebrations. Miss you all. Love to Nan and prayers. Have a great time.
Bye. Bye.
It. I remember him playing his Hammond organ in the front room there, and sometimes I lived next door, so I could hear sometimes him playing away, obviously really enjoying playing his organ. I enjoyed him sometimes playing snooker with him in the front room as well, with the snooker table there, and having fun doing that. I remember the neat rows of leeks and onions and all that kind of stuff, the vegetables growing in the back garden, and he obviously took great care of those. And every year he would get a large delivery of manure to improve the soil, which I'm sure delighted the neighbours. I enjoyed his stories of when he was growing up, such as when Weston Favell was still a village and you had to walk to Northampton. There was a bit of distance between the village and Northampton. He spoke of his times in Wells next to the sea, and I think that was probably a particular favourite era that he enjoyed. And one of the things that he told me was he rented a TV while he was there, and he went to return it before coming back to Northampton, and he said, "Sir, here's my TV, my name's Mr. Kinning," and they couldn't find a Mr. Kinning, and it was because the person who'd rented out the television had called him Mr. Chippy, because he was a carpenter. And occasionally they were hearing the stories of his time during World War II, such as the one where one of his colleagues would always sit in a plane on a helmet. And when he asked why that was, the reply was, "Well, there ain't no German going to shoot me in the backside," or words to that effect. Of course, one day the helmet did actually save him from a bullet, believe it or not. He was a contented person. He had as long as he had a warm house and good food on the table, that was what mattered, which made buying a present for him impossible. If you got him a nice new cardigan, it was folded up, put away in the drawer, and he would continue to wear his old threadbare one. He had an awareness and an interest in current affairs and what was going on in my life. He would often ask about work or church or what I was doing. He didn't dwell on himself, but he had a genuine interest in others. And I liked the way that he treated people and listened, whatever walk of life and whatever background you were from. For example, the time when he got on a bus and sat down next to another gentleman, saying, "I thought I'd sit down next to the best-looking person on the bus," which of then, of course, started a conversation between them until Grandpa got off the bus. He was a family-orientated man. He loved his wife and remained faithful to her for over 70 years, and he loved spending time with his sons and other family members. And he had a wry sense of humour. There's one time when I asked him, what did you do during the war, Grandpa? He says, I was a kamikaze pilot, but I missed. And while expressing his lack of understanding regarding technology, he says, can you eat internet cookies? I think he knew the answer was no. As Azul Rubin said, he had a great sense of positivity. And it was displayed during his refusal to be downbeat after falling and breaking his thigh bones. Instead, he was joking with the nurses, and I think he was one of their more popular patients. One thing I absolutely admired about him was his love for God and his hunger for him never, ever diminished. He maintained an interest in the Word of God and what the content of my preaches were on the occasions I preached. He always had a heart of praise and worship to God. You just had to start a bit of music and suddenly, oh, he was there enjoying or was suddenly praying. His heart was just totally and completely for God, even in times of sickness and in difficulty. When I was a child, I thought my grandparents were old. Of course they were. They were there, and it always seemed like they would be. And with Grandpa reaching the age of 100, it seemed almost like he would live forever. But more importantly than the age he reached, he leaves a spiritual legacy behind him in his sons, which in turn has been passed on to me and which I now benefit from and enjoy and for which I am eternally grateful for. I consider myself fortunate to call him Grandpa, and I thank God for the time that I had with him and the time that I spent with him. Thank you. I almost forgot I was doing a reading. John 14, verses 1 to 6. Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I am going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going. And Thomas said to him, Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way? Jesus answered, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me.
I think we're now going to have another video tribute.
As I look around the room, your Bible, glasses. This is a tribute to my dear dad-in-law. The chair is empty as I look around the room. Your Bible, glasses, chocolate and biscuits are still there. Shared conversation of life, politics, cars, music, books, but most of all about the Lord Jesus Christ, our Saviour. Little saying said with a twinkle in your eye. You have today, live it. Keep on keeping on. But Dad, I never understood one of your sayings. Horses' eyes, they magnifies and makes you bigger in what you am. I know that one day I shall join you around the throne in heaven, praising our Lord Jesus Christ and Saviour. And though you will be missed, I do not mourn as those without hope, because you were an example of hope, and we shared that common bond that Jesus is our hope. For your steadfast faith, I honour you. For your wisdom and integrity, I honour you. For your love and kindness, I thank you, dear Dad.
Hi everyone. Grandpa. His huge vegetable garden, his homemade pickled onions that no one can ever make like he did, his knitted cardigans, his tickles that as a child actually hurt us more than made us laugh, his chair sat next to Nan in their living room, that stubborn streak that I can see a bit of in all of us Kinnings, that cheeky glint and sparkle in his eye and quick wit that he never lost, his ever positive attitude to live life to the full, and that youthful spirit he had though his body was old, his steadfastness to family and the way he loved dear Nan, and the way he lit up whenever you mentioned the name Jesus. Of course, he wasn't perfect, but I've never met anybody quite like him, and I feel so privileged. He was my grandpa and my children's great-grandpa. One of my favourite last memories of him was when we went to visit him in hospital for the second time that he'd broken his thigh on his 100th birthday. It became a bit of a joke that God had planned another mission trip for him to hospital because he was in and out of hospital so much in those last few years. And as already has been said, the hospital staff and fellow patients completely loved him, and he didn't waste an opportunity to share about Jesus. Just before we were leaving, Matt started to pray for him, and as often is the case with Matt, emotion overtook him a little bit. He paused to take a breath. Grandpa jumped right in. He didn't miss the moment. He started praying very loud, speaking in tongues, getting really excited, literally, so the whole ward heard it all. He just could not contain himself. I read in a book just a couple of weeks ago, the most prominent common denominator that I've observed in Jesus' followers who appear to age joyfully is the fullness of the Holy Spirit. Simply put, the health of their souls and the attentiveness to the things of the Spirit manage to outshine the decline of their bodies. It also seems to leave a permanent mark. Their faces are lined with kindness, their eyes sparkle and easily fill with tears upon the mention of the name of Jesus. And as I read those words, I felt as though the author must know Grandpa. That was him to a T, and I wholeheartedly agree with her. His joy came from the Lord. That was who he lived for, and he couldn't help but emanate that. He's always been there, but now he's not, and we will miss him. But he lives on in our hearts and in and through us. I know that he will have had that welcome in heaven that we all want to hear. Well done, good and faithful servant. And I can only hope, as my dad said, that I grow up to be just like him. So here's to you, Grandpa, until we meet again.
Thank you, Jo, that was beautiful. And we're going to have our final video tribute, Sarah from Australia.
Today, as we celebrate the life of Ted, my special grandpa, I'd like to share some of the memories that I have of him. As a child, I used to love going to grandma and grandpa's. And I remember when I was very young, I'd help grandpa in his amazing garden with all his amazing, lovely vegetables. He even used to sneak some broccoli into my mash, and I only realised until I was a bit older. As I got older, we used to go to grandma and grandpa's on a Thursday afternoon after school. Daniel and I would have our piano lessons next door with Auntie Diane, and I would play tiddlywinks with grandma or try and beat grandpa at a game of snooker. I don't think I ever won. Dad and grandpa would sometimes stand by the organ and sing songs together, and the house would be filled with laughter and chatter as we talked about all sorts and joked whilst drinking tea and having a digestive or two. I can recall that even when I'd had a rubbish day at school, I'd go to grandma and grandpa's and come away feeling so positive, so refreshed, not worrying about school anymore, about how my day had been, but just feeling encouraged, loved, and full of hope again. But that's grandpa. His love for life, for his family, and for Jesus just radiated through everything that he did and said. He was so positive and inspiring. I never heard grandpa say a bad word about anybody. He would just speak life into everybody that he met, be it an encouraging word, a compliment, a quick prayer, or even just making you laugh. People were so blessed when they spent time with Grandpa. I'm reminded of his roaring laugh, which I can still hear, his hearty laugh, which used to ring out with a twinkle in his eye. He was so quick-witted and so funny. He used to give the best bear hugs, and he used to sing contentedly to himself as he was busying himself in the kitchen or in the garden. Make the most of the time you have now, he used to say. Grandpa was also very wise. Grandpa's thirst to continually grow his mind and knowledge through reading and understanding different topics and current affairs and spending time with the Lord inspires me today. He was always keen to encourage people to look forwards, not backwards. As I've gotten older, those memories and experiences of such loving grandparents have helped shape who I am today. Grandpa's love for his family and his faith in Jesus have greatly impacted my life. He was someone who didn't just talk the talk, but he walked the walk of faith. Grandpa knew who he was in God, that he was loved unconditionally, and he had a perfect assurance that one day he would see his Lord and Savior face to face. I fondly remember some of his sayings, keep on looking up, and he'd point to heaven and smile, or keep on keeping on, or you go, girl. Grandpa's legacy and love for his family and for the Lord will forever live on in my heart and in my family with my husband, Adam. I love you, Grandpa, and I'm so proud to be your granddaughter. Thank you for all the love, the encouragement, the prayers, the joy, the happy times and fun that you've given me. I know that you have a rich reward in heaven, and I know that one day we will all be rejoicing together.
I don't know about you, but I'm just blown away. They've been fabulous. Five powerful testimonies from grandchildren, daughter-in-law. Beautiful, beautiful. Going to invite us all to stand for our third hymn, Great is Your Faithfulness.
This is a song that maybe not too you might not be too familiar with, but it's quite a simple tune, and we've chosen it because of the words about great is your faithfulness. It's a tune that you'll soon get used to, but just enjoy it and see what these words have to say to us. It's stuff that Dad would say himself. Definitely he would say himself.
Your goodness and grace. Lord, I will follow, so take the lead. My life is not my own. My surrender, take all I am. I trust in you alone. I know when the night falls all around, if darkness should cloud my way, with songs of victory, you lead me on until that glorious day. Great is your faithfulness to me. Great is your faithfulness. Your good. The sun gives way, and when my race is run, with hopes of heaven, I will confess, great is your faithfulness. With hopes of heaven,
please take your seats. We've heard nothing but about God's faithfulness to Ted this afternoon. It's been wonderful. And before I bring my hopefully short talk, I just want to bring your attention to, in your order of service, there's a mention of Lighthouse Trust, which I know is a Christian ministry charity that was very dear to Ted's heart. And there's an opportunity to give to this organization. So if you just have a take a look at the message that's in the order of service, and if you wish to make a donation, the family are requesting that we give to the Lighthouse Trust. It's a ministry that takes the word of God into schools and supports education through various different ways. So I'm going to just call my talk Leaving a Legacy that Outlives Your Lifespan. I'm going to ask, please, if possible, if I could just have a bit of light, because I suddenly can't see my message. I first met Ted and Nancy when I attended Elim Christian Center in 1988. And it was at a Bible study one evening, and there was an assistant pastor at that time, a gentleman called Alistair Porter. And at the end of the Bible study, he invited people to come forward for prayer. And I remember he called Ted, this man Ted, to come and pray with him. And I went up for prayer, and Alistair and Ted were praying with me, and, well, Ted was praying, actually. And the next one moment, I was like, you know, sort of standing there with my eyes shut, hands together, receiving prayer. And the next moment, I remember opening my eyes, and I could see feet and ankles. And I thought, why am I seeing feet and ankles? And no, Ted hadn't knocked me out, but I tell you that the power of his prayer and God's power just touched me through that really powerful prayer. I didn't even know what had gone on, but I sort of remember sort of getting up thinking, whoa. But I knew who it was that had prayed for me, and I just thought, stay close to that man. And over the years, Ted and Nancy and I became very close, and I would sort of regard him as my sort of spiritual granddad. Such an amazing, amazing man. You know, in the Bible readings we've heard today, to Ted, the personal return of Jesus Christ was really important, and heaven. They were two subjects that were constantly things that Ted talked about. And for Ted, meeting Jesus was going to happen one of two ways. It was either going to be that Jesus was going to physically return and collect Ted and take him home, just like he'd promised his disciples, or he was going to shut his eyes permanently, open his eyes, and then see Jesus. And we know that's the second way. That's the way that it was for Ted. The first Bible reading talks about the hope that Christians have for those who accept Jesus Christ. And for those who accept Jesus, like Ted, and for his family that you've heard from today, it's not a, you know, cross my fingers kind of hope, or a, you know, a hope it'll all come out in the wash kind of hope. And it's neither a hope I've been good enough kind of hope. It's a hope that is certain and steadfast. And the nature of Christian hope is that it is a substance of evidence leading to a confident expectation that what you believe, you know, will happen. Not that you believe or you hope will happen, you know will happen. That's the nature of the Christian hope. And Ted staked his life on the very fact that the one who had forgiven him all of his sin would keep his promise to him and either come and physically fetch him himself or let him come home to him. We run a Bible school, Every Nation Bible School, UK. And in 2016, we announced to the students the following week. I'm going to have to put these on now. We announced to the students the following week that we were having two special guests. I'd invited Ted and Nancy because I thought, well, if at the age of 95 or 96, you are still ragingly on fire for Jesus, we've got something we can learn from you and need to learn from you. So I never told the students who the guests were. I said Reinhard Bonnke, he couldn't make it. And for me, Ted and Nancy consistently demonstrated the fire of God in their lives. And I felt it was just appropriate that they come and share that with Bible students. So knowing Ted was a bit of an early bird, I said, look, Ted, if you want to come for about 45 minutes and then go home, that's fine. You know, we'll carry on the class afterwards, because I didn't want to be accused of keeping them up and starving them of their beauty sleep. So Ted and Nancy pulled up, Rob brought them, and they arrived the same time as some of the students, and they got out of the car and they were sort of walking ever so slowly like this, and the students had remembered we've got special guests, and they sort of looked at me with that sort of Northampton tone of voice, and they said, "Why, Elaine?" And I said, I know they were thinking, "You've lost the plot." And I said, don't judge a book by its cover. And so we had devotions and introduced Ted and Nancy, who at that time had been married for over 70 years, still loving Jesus with a passion. And both Ted and Nancy shared of their lifetime journey walking with Jesus. And Ted in particular spoke of the Holy Spirit and moving in the power of the Holy Spirit. And at the end of Ted's talk, we invited anybody that wanted Ted to pray with them to come, because I was thinking, come and pray, come and let him pray, and then he can go. The class moved as one man, students and tutors. They just moved, whoom, to the front. And Ted stood for over 45 minutes, laid hands on every student and prayed. Rob prayed as well, but I mean, he's got youth on his side. But this man's 96 and he prayed for every person. And I just thought, man, that is just a practical demonstration that at 96 years old, a lifetime of walking with Jesus adds strength to your life. It was such a powerful evening. And I was speaking to one of our former students just a few nights ago, and they were saying, I remember when he came and prayed. What a powerful evening that was. So I said to Ted, when he was 100, I said, okay, Ted, and Nancy, because she was 99, I said, what's the secret of long life? This is what they said. Eat plenty of vegetables. Vegetarians would love that. Do everything in moderation and keep looking to Jesus. We've heard already that he would say, keep looking up. He'd say, don't look at me. Don't look in. Don't look around. Don't look down. Keep looking up. Look at him. Look at him, the one who is altogether lovelier than anything that is lovely. Ted would not allow anything to come between him and his relationship with Jesus. And he would not allow his own situation, experiences, or opinion to influence what the Lord might want to do. I would say of Ted, he was never an objective man. He was a God-jective man. And Ted would say of Jesus, I know whom I've believed, and I am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him until that day. Ted was persuaded that Jesus was able to keep his life, and keep his life he did, because he had committed his life to Jesus until the day that Jesus took him home. And if Ted were here today, he would ask you this question: do you know whom you've believed, and are you persuaded that he is able? And if your response to Ted was going to be no, or I don't know, he would say, well, you'd better get on a no then, hadn't you? In our self-obsessed Western culture, many regard senior years as the frailty of old age with physical and mental weaknesses. However, the Hebrew culture regards old age with respect, wisdom, not taken by surprise. Someone who has seen kingdoms come and go. Ted has seen kingdoms come and go. He's lived under 30 prime ministers, 5 monarchs. Anybody over 70 will have lived under 2 monarchs in this room today. But Ted lived under 5. I've lived under 1. And we know what's happening right now. He lived through the outbreak of World War II and its conclusion. He witnessed the birth of the nation of Israel, the shrinking of the British Empire, the Berlin Wall going up, and was told it's going to stay there for 1,000 years, but 30 years later it came down. The rise and demise of great leaders, 3 global financial crashes, the end of the Cold War, and the list goes on. Ted saw all these temporary things pass away, and he has now gone home to the kingdom of God, and that, my friend, will last forever. The time came when Ted was physically unable to attend church, but that wasn't going to stop him doing anything. He fell and broke his pelvis, and it was as though God gave him his own church. Ted shared the love of God in hospital, praying with staff, praying with patients, ministering God's love to people. And he was not given a new pelvis because he was told he was too old and he'd not survive the operation. But as if to prove his indestructibility, he went on to make a full recovery. But that wasn't enough. The following year, Ted then broke one of his femurs, I can't remember which one it was at the time, went back in hospital, and he had the time of his life. He had his own private ward, sharing and praying and ministering to people. I just thought, talk about patient at large. Jesus said, he that believes in me, out of him will flow rivers of living water. And Jesus made this promise because his desire was that as you were refreshed by his living water, you too would be a refresher of others. I'm going to suggest that Ted was definitely a river of living waters. He was a river that flowed victoriously, persistently, overcoming every obstacle. He refreshed himself in the Lord and was in turn a refresher of others. And whenever I visited Ted and Nancy, I always left feeling I just spent time in the presence of Jesus. Afflictions and hardships and challenges are said to prepare you for greater things ahead. They can do that, but I also believe they reveal the character and content of your heart and the decisions that you've made based on what you've been through in your life up to that point. Ted was not a coward or a weak man, nor a man of fear. He was a man with a resolute faith in God, and he faced every Goliath, squaring up to it with a, yeah, bring it on, my God's going to sort you out. You heard that he was viciously attacked at the age of 84, and I visited him, and I was heartbroken at what I saw. And I said, man, if I could get my hands on that thug that did that. And he said, no. He said, no, Elaine. He said, my only desire is that this man comes to the Lord Jesus. And I said, Ted, let me be angry on your behalf. Ted said, don't be angry. He said, pray for this man that he would find Jesus Christ. Oh, yes, Ted knew who he'd believed, and he was well persuaded. Ted made a life, had a lifetime of positive choices to trust God no matter what the situation. And I believe his resolution to embrace adversity was a product of the decisions and choices he'd made in the prayer closet of yesterday and yesteryear. How else would a man in his 90s survive and face and overcome, and survive skin cancer, a broken pelvis, a broken left femur, a broken right femur, and most recently the coronavirus, and still say, oh, isn't God great? Never complained about anything, ever. Sometimes I'd think, oh, go on, have a moan, Ted. Come on, have a moan. But he never did. Get angry with that, Ted. Never did. Sometimes when he was talking, I would just look at his body and just look at this aging body. And I was astounded at the spiritual authority and power that came out of this man. He was full of the Holy Spirit. He was full of wisdom. He was a man that had stoked up decades of prayer. One day after one of his falls, I visited Ted and Nancy. Richard was in the house. And as I entered and I saw Ted was covered in bruises, Richard said, Elaine, I need you to talk to my dad. I said, why? What's going on? He said, look at him. He said, he's fallen over again. I can't do anything with him. And before I could say anything to Ted, he said, yo, yeah, what are you going to do about it? He said, I'm still here, ain't I? And he punched it, hallelujah, like this. You know, and I thought, he had that twinkle in his eye. One day he said to me, I've got two legs, they're no good. Two arms, they're weak. Two eyes, I can't see properly. Two ears, I can hardly hear a thing. Two nostrils, and I can't smell. Can't taste my food, but it's all great. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. And he wasn't being cool or trendy or super spiritual. It's what he genuinely believed. He meant it. He meant it. He never wrote a book. There were no letters after his name. He never received an award from the Queen. No national or international accolades, not a conference speaker, never appeared on CNN, TBN or God TV, simply known as Ted. I'm going to say that in all the unseen activities of his 37,391 days of his life, when he was unapplauded, unrecognized, ignored and obscured, he consistently, and we've heard that word so many times today, demonstrated humility, compassion, honor, and integrity. And when he was overlooked and underestimated, his Father in heaven, who honors and values the unseen, sometimes more than the seen, declared his love and acceptance of Ted, not because of what he'd done, but because of who he was in Christ. And I do believe there was a fanfare the day Ted came home to Jesus. Jackie Stewart said of the Queen, she's the most amazing woman I've ever met in my life. I'm going to say of Ted Kinning, I believe he's the godliest man I've ever met in my life. In your booklet, you read a story from Ted of how somebody suggested he was intense. Yeah, we could all do with an intense faith like Ted. Because he was forever thankful to the God that took intense measures to save him from the penalty of sin. The Bible says that those who have been forgiven much love much. So now we know that Ted is otherwise occupied. I know for certain that he would want me to tell you about what he believed and why and how you can be assured of a place in heaven. Ted was 42 years old when God touched his heart and invited him to repent of his sin. Ted had never been a gun-running gangster or anything like that. He was a good husband to Nancy and a great dad to his three sons. Yet he knew he needed to repent of his sin. He knew he needed to be saved by the Saviour of the world. And so you might say, well, how does a good guy need to repent? You see, if we compare Ted to Stalin or Bin Laden, he'd come out 100% a better man. If we compared him to Mother Teresa or, say, Marie Curie, we might spot a few shortcomings. But God did not compare Ted to Bin Laden or Mother Teresa. He compared him to the life of his one and only son, the perfect Jesus Christ. And like all human beings, Ted was found seriously wanting. And as no one is innocent of sin, it's required that every person needs to be forgiven of their sin to be acceptable to God. And the way to be forgiven is to repent. And repent means to confess and acknowledge that you've done wrong before God and choosing to turn away from what you know to be wrong. You see, in Jesus, there is no sin. He never raised his voice. He never had a bad thought. There was never any deceit found in his mouth. And he was the only one good enough and perfect enough to die on the cross for the sins of the world. Ted staked his life on the fact that God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. Ted knew that his problem was the same as everyone else's, that being we've all turned, gone our own way and exercised our own selfish, independent nature. And I think those three words, sin for short. Ted agreed with the Bible that he had sinned and fallen short of God's perfect standards. And the result of his own personal sin was his separation from God. And furthermore, he realized that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Jesus. So in response to the sin of humanity, God reached out in compassion, demonstrating his love for us, that while we were still sinners and sinning, Jesus died for us. Jesus Christ physically died on a cruel cross to take away the sins of the world. And the most important issue concerning the death of Jesus Christ is that 3 days later he rose up from the dead, because that was what broke the power of sin off humanity. The death and resurrection is the basis of Ted's and indeed every person's access into heaven. And you see, God gave Ted a choice. No one forced him to believe, and I think we all know enough about Ted to know that you couldn't make him believe anything. He wasn't really going to believe. And Ted made this choice freely and willingly. He came to Jesus Christ. Ted confessed and repented of his sin and accepted Jesus as his Lord and Savior. Ted became a Christian. You see, weak people don't trust Jesus. Strong men, strong women, they trust Jesus. And they trust the invisible God to give them his strength to live their visible lives in this visible world. And Ted's faith stood the test of time. It wasn't a 6-minute flash in the pan or a 6-week wonder. It was 60 years of powerful supernatural living. I'm going to say here that Ted, the man, did not die. His mortal body that he lived in, that died. But Ted, the man, was made immortal by the power of Jesus Christ, and he is alive in heaven with Jesus. Ted left earth alive and entered heaven alive. Ted closed his eyes for the last time on the 7th of July, Friday afternoon. Next destination, heaven. First person he saw was his beloved Savior, the Lord Jesus. The Bible is very clear. There is no annihilation. There is no reincarnation. There is no nothing. It's appointed for man to die once and then face God in judgment. You may be here today, you know of Ted's faith, and yet you don't share that faith. And I'm going to say to you what I know Ted would say. He would say this: if after hearing that lady talk, you feel in your heart that you want to become a Christian and give your life to Jesus, he would say, this is what you need to do. He'd say it's as easy as A, B, C. He'd say, A, admit to God that you have sinned against him and repent of all your sin. Then he'd say, B, believe that he sent his son Jesus to die for your sin. And then he'd say, C, confess him as your Lord and Savior and promise to live for him. So I'm just going to say a short prayer. And if you want to pray in the silence of your heart with me, then you can do that. Dear Father, I believe you sent your son Jesus to die for me. I believe that Jesus rose from the dead, and through him I can know you. I realize that I have sinned and fallen short of your ways. I believe that Jesus died for me and took all my punishment, and I'm truly sorry for all that I've done wrong against you. I now repent and I ask you to forgive me of my sin and the consequences of them. I choose to turn away from my old ways to follow you and live my life for you. I give my heart and my life for you to be my Lord and Savior. I pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, and I thank you for hearing my prayer. Amen. And if you prayed this prayer in your heart, sincerely meaning it between you and God, then today I believe God's forgiven you your sin. But if you want to know more about becoming a Christian like Ted, then please see the personal invitation in the order of service to approach any one of Rob, Stuart, or Richard to talk more. And there is free literature available out in the coffee area if you want to take it. Ted loved the Lord Jesus Christ with all of his heart. He was devoted to him and making him known to others. And I know that Ted would want everybody in this room to know the Saviour just like he did. And in conclusion, I'm going to make a very bold claim about Ted. Often we hear people throw about the word, and I think it's thrown around quite loosely, that he's a legend, and he's no more a legend than a cup of tea. But I believe Ted Kinning's a legend, and I actually looked up the word. What does a legend mean? And a legend is someone who leaves behind an unforgettable impression on others. They touch lives, they are remembered, and they are cherished. And I believe that there is a Ted Kinning legacy that he's leaving behind to, in, and through his family. His three sons, their ages total 212 years. His eight grandchildren, their ages total 336 years. His nine great-grandchildren total 119 years. A total of 20 children and grandchildren from one life, representing 667 years. So I feel now I want to address the Kinning family. So I'm going to ask if every member of the Kinning family would stand, and even if you're a town or a something else, but you're related through a marriage, I'm going to ask you to stand, please. If you're able to. I know you're not able to, Liz, it's okay. And I want to address you, his family. The success of Ted's life is not found in what he did here while he was on the earth. The success of Ted's life is in you. You're his physical legacy as you stand here in this church today. And I'm going to pronounce what I believe to be a generational blessing upon the Kinning family. You are the legacy that is greater than Ted's lifespan. Ted's legacy is the fulfillment of the greater things you shall do in your lives because of the unforgettable impression that he made upon your life. And you will go on and do greater things than your dad and your granddad and your great-granddad because of the influence and the impact he's left behind and he had upon you. And that influence and impact is in you and on you because he is your very own personal legend. Ted leaves behind the generational blessing that has affected this family and been imparted to each and every one of you. May you always consider his touch upon your lives. May you always remember him, not merely through memories and the wonderful stories, but through the greater works yet to be done through each one of you. May you always cherish and honor the memory of this truly great man. George Bernard Shaw wrote, "I do not consider my life a candle. It is a splendid torch that I get to hold for a moment. I want to make it burn as brightly as possible before turning it over to the future generations." Ted's splendid torch burnt brightly for 102 years, 4 months and 7 days. You all now hold that glorious torch. Make it burn bright for Jesus, for yours and for the future generations. He touched and marked your lives. He touched and marked our lives. And we thank you for sharing him with us. You are the living legacy, outliving Ted's lifespan. And as you walk with God, you will excel in God and witness Ted's legendary legacy live on through the generational blessing upon your family. And that blessing will continue to manifest through you, and should the Lord tarry, your generations. And as Ted would say, today's today, live it. Thank you. You may take your seats. My final comments are coming concerning the person and the life of Ted John Kinning. I'm going to be summed up in 6 words. The Bible talks about love coming from a pure heart, a good conscience, and sincere faith. Ted was unspeakably humble. He was unsullenly pure, and he was undivided and absolutely devoted to God. Yes, he was intense. And finally, I'm going to give Ted the last word. He would say, friend, trust Jesus Christ. He is to be trusted because Jesus is faithful, reliable, dependable, loyal, and his integrity is beyond reproach. Trust him. That's what he would say today. Thank you for listening. Bless you. I'm going to ask us if we will stand for our final song together, 10,000 Reasons.
Just before we sing this final song, I just want to pay tribute and honour to Elaine here, who has led our service today. It was quite a few years ago that Dad asked Elaine if she would take his service, this type of service that we've had today, which was wonderful because he had such a deep relationship with Elaine. But what a lot of you may not know, Elaine went to live permanently in Jamaica back in June this year. She's gone to live there, and she's travelled all the way back from Jamaica to come to take this service. So can you please join with a clap? That is commitment. That is so special to us as a family. I said to Elaine, you don't have to keep that commitment, Elaine. That's, you know, to come back from Jamaica to do that, she said, I'm coming. Yeah. And if Elaine says something, you know she's going to do it. So, Elaine, thank you so much. It's been a delight to have you. And thank you to Peter for releasing you to come. We know it's so special, and that Dad was so special to you, but you're so special to us too. So thank you.
So bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I'll worship your holy name. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Worship.
For our closing prayer by Reverend Matt Town, Ted's grandson-in-law.
Thanks, Elaine. Well, what a privilege it's been to celebrate Grandpa's life, Ted's life today. And on behalf of the family, if this is okay, I just want to say thank you to you all for coming and being a part of this moment with us as a family. I just want to share one thing as I've just stood listening. I remember something that Ted once did when, as a family, went round to visit Grandpa and Nan in the house. He would often just get up as we were just sat in the room talking and toddle off into his pantry, if you remember, kids. And this one time he toddled off into the pantry, and I think the kids were a little bit excited. What was he going to bring back? And because he would always bring something back, often a jar of pickles, but this time he brought back, I think it was 2 boxes of Pringles. And we were excited, the kids were a little bit hungry, so we opened the Pringles and we started to eat the Pringles and then realised that they were actually a little bit soft. And then we looked at the packet and they were 2 years out of date. So we didn't say anything, of course, but it just made us chuckle because we don't know how long they'd been there. But I say that because Grandpa was just like a box of Pringles. Once you pop, you just can't stop. And he wasn't an ordained minister, but he was one of the best pastors that I knew. He was one of the best worship leaders that I knew. He was a really special man. And I just want to encourage you, whilst you stood and whilst I pray, I want you to close your eyes. And out of respect and honour for Ted, for Grandpa, would you just connect your heart with God's heart right now? You might not be a Jesus follower. You might not have faith. But don't miss this opportunity to connect with Ted's Heavenly Father, because he's yours too. Heavenly Father, we come before you now in prayer. We know that you're present with us. And we take this simple opportunity, just as Ted would take this opportunity, because once he started, he didn't stop. And if I get a bit emotional as I pray now, Grandpa, you've got no chance of stepping in to take over. But we want to take this opportunity to give you thanks for Grandpa's life, for Ted's life. We thank you because it was a life that was well lived in glory and honor of your name. Lord, we thank you because his strength was your joy. And Lord, we thank you for his love of life. We thank you for his love for people, that he would take every opportunity that he had to share your love with other people. We thank you more than anything else for his love for you. And the truth in scripture that we read in Psalm 91, it says, because he loves me, says the Lord, I will rescue him. I will protect him, for he acknowledges my name. He will call on me and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life, I will satisfy him and show him my salvation. We thank you, God, that you were true to your promise. Because Ted loved you, you gave him such a long life. And Nancy's too. We give you honor and glory for that. Lord, we thank you for this wonderful family and for friends that are gathered here today. I pray that you would be with them in their grief as they reflect upon such a deep loss in our lives, Lord God. We pray that you would bring comfort and strength. And Lord, as we've listened to Elaine's incredible TED talk today, I pray, God, that the legacy of Ted's life would live long in our own hearts and in our own lives. Would you do something in us today? Would you bring something that rested upon Ted's life and put it on ours, so that we can live our lives like he lived his, for your glory and for your honor, that we too would impact so many people's lives in the years ahead. Lord, we pray for Nancy. We just ask, Lord God, that you'd be her strength and shield. Lord God, that she would know your comfort and your peace. And Lord, that your joy would be her strength in these days and months. And Lord, we pray years ahead. We place her in your hands of care and comfort. And as we draw to a close, Heavenly Father, we want to give you all the glory and all the praise and all the honor that's due your wonderful name, because you are our Savior and our friend and our hope and our life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Matt. Thank you, Matt. You may take your seats. And simply in closing, I know the family would say, don't rush away. Please stay and have refreshments. There's refreshments that have been lovingly prepared. And don't forget, there will be a time if you want to share your special memory or tribute of Ted. We're going to have a time within our time together, and it will be a brief time. So maybe you want to be thinking about what you want to say, and we ask, because we want to try and get as many in as possible, just make them, you know, as short one-liners or two-liners. Thank you. Thank you for coming. Thank you for standing with the family at this time and supporting them. God bless you. Bye.